tomorrow, Brown Bag Packing. So if you haven't done that, I encourage you to give it a shot. We get a good group of people come out, gather together, and they pack little, basically supplemental bags for children in the schools. They put in drinks and snacks and all sorts of things, fun activities. So I would invite you to come on out and give them a hand. That'll be 9 a.m. down in the fellowship hall. The last announcement I have is pretty exciting. I wish I could do it, but I'm not creative. The preschool is still having their logo contest. So if you have a shred of creativity, a little bit of talent, feel free to submit your idea of what the logo should be for First Baptist Preschool. And that can go directly to Kelsey Brown, our preschool director. If you don't know who she is, I'm going to make her really uncomfortable. Kelsey, can you stand up real quick? There's our preschool director. Yeah. You stood up fantastic. You deserved a round of applause. So again, that's just a fun opportunity for you to be part of our church and what we do in the community. I mean, it really is a blessing in ministry, so take a chance, submit your ideas. Now, before we pray, I see some newer faces. So let's take a minute, kind of look around, wave at each other, say hi, greet them, be safe. What's up, buddy? All right. Let's pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for the opportunity you've given us to be present today in your house, to worship you as one united body of believers here at First Baptist. We pray that you would receive our praise and be glorified through the service. We pray all this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. I invite you to stand and worship with us this morning.
We're going to give God some glory this morning with "To God Be the Glory."
Father, through Jesus. Just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy.
You stood before creation, eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failure and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, soul now to stand. So what can I say? And what can I do? But offer this heart, O God, completely to
Father, what a wonderful day to be in your house, to be in this warm place with this wonderful group of people that you brought together as a family. And Lord, we know that you are always with us, no matter what goes on around us, no matter how things fall apart around us. You are always there to support us and to love us and to hold us up. And we rest in those strong arms of yours. And Lord, part of that are the many, many, many blessings that you pour out upon us just over and over and over. And this morning, we bring just a small portion of those huge blessings back to you, and we give it back to you, and we ask that you take that blessing and you multiply it, and you take us out into that world that needs you so desperately so that we can bring that love and that peace and that joy and that strength to them. In Christ's name, amen.
We'd like you to keep standing with us as we sing our new song of the month.
I was lost in shame, could not get past my blame, till he called my name. I'm so glad he saved me, darkness held me down, but Jesus pulled me out. I'm no longer bound. I'm so glad he saved me.
At this point in the service, I'd like to invite our children to stand up, head back, and follow our volunteers. You'll see them in the FBC Kids shirts. And again, that is for 3 up through 5th grade. They do not have to go, but if they would like to go, it's a great time. Snacks, fun, learn about Jesus. All right. Well, I'm gonna throw an audible real quick because I forgot my clicker. Can I get somebody to bring me my clicker? Thank you, sir. It's even working. All right. So last Sunday, when we got together, we talked about making sure our hope remains in Christ. We talked about it with the cute little, the cute little saying, our hope in Christ, not the calendar. I hope you remembered that. You know, the calendar being an example of the flesh, the ways of the world. And we saw that hoping in or waiting upon the Lord will renew our strength that we may be able to carry on serving him in a strong and capable manner. So we're carrying along that same type of topic, that subject matter of hope. But instead of just telling you, hey, let's hope in God, over the next couple weeks, we're going to look at different ways we can do that, different things we can do to help us keep our hope in Christ. Today, we're looking at prayer. Right? And prayer is something that any believer is familiar with, at least on the surface. So today we're not going to dive in really deep. We're not doing a huge deep study on what prayer is, but instead we're going to look at how prayer is and how it helps us in keeping our hope with Christ. And I'm going to throw this disclaimer out there. There may be some of you right now sitting in your seat saying, I've been a Christian for many years. I know prayer is important. I'm about to take a nap. I would encourage you, don't take a nap, and we'll see why shortly. Let us hear the word of the Lord. Matthew 26:36-41. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Excuse me. Then he said to them, the three, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed. Pay attention to this. My Father, if possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet, not as I will, but as you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Let's pray. Almighty Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to be present in your house, Lord, to worship you through the singing of your praise, to the hearing of your word, and the coming together of your saints. I pray now, Lord, that you would speak through me, that my inadequacies, my failures would not hinder the ability of the people here to hear your word. We thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So this passage, many of you are familiar with the context of what's going on here, right? So Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. This is just after it's the night basically he was betrayed and then wound up being arrested. He had gone through and is in a place of, as we heard, sorrow, trouble, sorrow. As I stop this passage partway through, right? And basically the remaining part of this story is the same exact scenario occurs. Jesus goes to pray, comes back, his disciples are sleeping. Goes to pray, comes back, finds his disciples sleeping. And then after that, the scenario probably would have played out continually, but it ended because that's when they came to arrest Jesus. Well, that's a whole other lesson. Let's stop there and focus on what happens right before this arrest plays out. The betrayal actually occurs, and Jesus is arrested. Jesus, our Savior, the Son of God, he's facing the fact that he knows the end is near, as far as this worldly standard goes. We know that he knows the crucifixion is coming. And how does Jesus respond to that? How would you respond to that? If you knew in a couple hours you were going to be betrayed, arrested, leading to your death, what would you do? Right, we've seen it different times. Probably not a best example, but you'll understand. When you're on death row, you get a final meal, right? Like, hey, go ahead, be a glutton, eat whatever you want. You're about to die. But now, if you were knowing what's going to happen, would you go spend time with family? Would you try to get all your affairs in order? Would you try to run from what's coming next? What did Jesus do? He takes his disciples, heads to the garden, which they've used previously for prayer. He prays. In verse 36, which is on the screen right there, gives us that answer. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." Earlier in that evening, Jesus had pointed out Judas as the betrayer, celebrated Passover, instituted communion, foretold Peter's denial, and how does that night culminate? He goes to pray, knowing that later, the end of this story, beginning of another one, will start unfolding. All that going on, all that about to occur, and Jesus' priority was prayer. So what does that tell us? Well, let's see. I think it's pretty simple, right? Prayer needs to be a priority for the believer. Seems simple enough to say, right? Prayer needs to be a priority. That's the first point of this sermon, right? Prayer needs to be a priority. It is not a passing. It is not a comfort term. I'll pray for you. It needs to be a priority. Let's pray. As believers, we need to make prayer a priority every single day, as we are blessed with life. Just as we see Jesus providing that example, prayer needs to be where we go. So we've established that pretty simply. I don't need to talk on it too much. Prayer, priority. Let's move on farther, and we'll see what's going on. So we talked about the context of what's been occurring that evening. We talked about prayer, the priority. As we move on, we see now that Jesus had taken his three closest disciples farther into the garden. So he took all his disciples there and said, hey, wait here while I go pray. He took his three closest and went deeper. And he says to them, and I don't want you to miss this, okay? Jesus, our Savior, God in the flesh, confides to his people, his closest group. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Jesus is going through some incredible things at this point. We've talked about them already. All these traumatic and emotionally taxing and just a mess of things occurring, and he knows where it ends that night. And he takes his closest core group and confides in them. And what does he say after he tells them that he is going through all this turmoil, this pain, this sorrow, to the point of death? He says, stay here and keep watch with me. Keeping watch, what are we talking about? Right, some people hear and they think, oh, because the rest is coming, so they want to stand guard. Kind of. But how many of you have been in a very painful or trying situation in your life and you just want your people with you? You just want them with you. You want them to be present in the moment. You don't want them sitting there playing on their phones or sleeping. You just want them present in the moment with you while you are going through these challenges. That's not familiar to anybody? I hope so. I hope you have that type of connection somewhere where you just want your people. So stay here and keep watch with me. And what I see here, two little sentences there, what I see here is how this reminds us that prayer is vital for relationships, especially with God. He could have sat and prayed with his whole big group of followers. He asked them to stay and took his three with him. Stay here with me while I pray. I personally get blown away thinking about God in the flesh confiding to a mortal man that he is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. That gets me every time I read that. So prayer is vital to relationship. And then additionally, we see that prayer is a means of comfort. Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed. My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Now there's a whole sermon just in that section, but we're going to focus on prayer. Again, God in the flesh, Jesus Christ, walks a little farther and falls face to the ground. Now, I had originally thought I was going to throw myself on the ground here, but I remembered I got a mic in my pocket. But visualize that. Have you ever seen somebody in such pain that they just throw themselves down? Now, maybe they don't lay face down on the ground, or maybe they throw themselves into a pillow or onto a bed, to a couch. They're just physically collapsing into this emotion. And Jesus does that. But not to cry about it. Not to express how angry he is or bitter he is about the cards that he was dealt, so to speak. To pray. Now this next part I'm going to try to get through without choking up. If I do, sorry, not really. But the image that came to my mind as I read through this little section here, and visualizing Jesus just throwing himself to the ground to pray, is something I can relate to pretty recently. And I bet many of you can as well, at some level. My only living grandmother passed away shortly before Thanksgiving this past year. And I found myself hurting like I haven't hurt in a long time. I've shared with you before, my time in the Marine Corps has really helped me dial into what I would call emotional constipation. That's a great visual, I know. I'm sorry. But I feel these emotions, but they mean nothing to me. I just, whatever, and we move on. And I've been praying for years that the Lord heal me from that, release me from that, because I feel like it's very important for us to express the emotions the Lord has given us. And the first time in many years, as I learned of my grandmother's passing, I acknowledged the hurt that was really present. And while I talked on the phone, I held it together. Thank you for letting me know. How did this happen? Whatever. And then right after, I walked a little bit farther. Going a little farther, yep. I walked a little bit farther into my home. And I broke down into tears. Not only did I break down crying, but I find myself falling into my wife's arms. Now, if you know my wife, she's tiny. I'm not particularly tiny. But I found myself comforted by her embrace. As I expressed my hurt and my pain, I was falling down into my comfort, into the arms of my wife. In our relationship and the comfort she provided, I continued to cry, but we talked and we prayed together. And I had comfort. Now, comfort does not remove the pain, but it comforts the pain. Just like a comforter doesn't get rid of the cold, it's still cold outside, but when you're under that comforter, you're comfortable. Okay? And I visualize Jesus doing that exact same thing. He's falling into the arms of his Father. When Carla prayed this morning, she talked about the strong arms of God holding us. And that's exactly what occurs when we turn to him. So we see Jesus with the sorrow and this pain, and he falls into the arms of his almighty Father and talks to him. My Father, if it's possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. He's talking to his Father. When we talk to the Father, we're praying. That's what is occurring here. Jesus is doing the exact thing that he expects us to do. And not only do we make that physical and personal in our own lives with our spouses and those close to us, but we too can and should fall into the arms of our Heavenly Father. What does that mean? Or what does that do? Prayer provides peace and comfort. There are things that we don't want to talk about with other people. There are things that we just feel we can't express to other folks. You can tell your Heavenly Father anything, and his embrace will not lessen. Prayer needs to be a priority. Prayer provides peace and comfort. Let's keep going. Verse 40. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. I kind of touched on this a little bit ago. When you want your people present, you want them present. There are times we shouldn't have to give explicit instruction. One of the examples I've seen numerous times and is kind of making a pushback is dinner time. If you're having a family meal, are phones allowed at the table? Sometimes. Some people know. But that's one of the things you've seen numerous times, like, hey, this is family. This is time to be present together. So here we see that. He returned from praying to his disciples and found them sleeping. Last week I gave kind of a visual of what I thought when I read. And this one, I'm reading it, I kind of see Jesus walking in, and this may not be accurate. This is my perception on it. Very similar to in the Marine Corps when you're on watch. Right? There's some of you who are assigned watch where you are alert and pay attention, and you're present in the moment. And if you fall asleep or something along those lines, you can get a kick. Right, so as I'm reading this, I'm seeing Jesus walk back and seeing his closest disciples sleeping. Maybe kick their feet a little bit, get their attention. Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? You guys know who I am. I've told you what's going to occur. 1 hour, you couldn't do it. And some people make big emphasis on this point that he asked that to Peter. Okay, but in the Greek, it's a plural thing. He's talking to the three of them. And I'm going to paint this a little more. You can kind of visualize it even more. He just gets done expressing the tremendous sorrow that he's facing. And I don't know how to emphasize that enough. It says, even to death, which means that would seem like a better alternative to what he's experiencing. So he is hurting. He just expresses that to his closest disciples, to the ones who've said, I will never forsake you. I will always be present. I'll never turn against you. They just got done expressing all that. Of course, Jesus knows better. But he shares with them that point anyway, how pain-soaked he is right now. He wanted them to participate in what he was doing, and they fall asleep. Let's make that personal again. Put that into your life. Okay? You have a loved one who's in the process of going back to heaven. You go to spend time with them. And you see your brother, your sister, sitting there, feet kicked up, playing on their phones, maybe watching videos. How would that make you feel? Is that acceptable? Is that something like, oh, that seems like a great idea? Or does that kind of stir something inside? It's like, what are you doing? What are you doing? I shouldn't have to tell you when we go in there, give attention where attention's due. That's just to be expected. That's what's supposed to occur when you love somebody. And these are the ones who've been with Jesus through the big moments. Transfiguration, walking on water, all the miracles. These guys were there. And they fall asleep. I know how I would respond. That kick wouldn't have been a little tap to the feet. Jesus doesn't do that. He comes back. He's still in pain. He comes back. He sees him sleeping. His response is what? Well, he does faithfully, like he always does, points out their inability to be faithful. He doesn't beat them with it. He doesn't rip into them. He points out their inability to be faithful. So what does that show us about prayer? Because again, this is our focus this morning, is how prayer can help us keep our hope. So what does that particular section show us about prayer? Well, prayer can be easily neglected if it's not a priority. I've said it several times. These men have been walking along Jesus' side throughout his ministry. They've witnessed all the things that Jesus has done. They know who he is. There's not a matter of faith involved. You see it, right? Now, there's other things where faith is vitally important, and Jesus tells us that throughout. But these guys walked alongside him while he did these miracles. and they neglected prayer. And this is why I encourage you not to take your nap. Even those closest to Jesus, who lived with him, shared meals with him, participated in his miracles, cast out demons in his name, gave in to sleep instead of praying for their Savior who was going through these trials and pain. There's nothing left that I think would trump that. How could we find anything else that would make it more important for us to pray than knowing our Savior is struggling to the point of death, and he exclaimed that out of his own mouth? But they did. And Jesus pointed it out. And he says to them, right, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Does this sound relatable to any of you? We know what happened to the people who were right there, so I would imagine it absolutely does. We know the power in the role of prayer. Believers constantly say, I'll pray for you. I'm praying for you. How can I pray for you? How many of you are praying for them? Will pray for them? Remember what it is they asked you to pray for. Now, this is not a beat you up. This is a truth. Jesus tells us, hey, our flesh is weak. We really want to do the right thing. We really want to pray for these people. We really want to pray for our family, our church, our country. But we let the responsibilities of our life interfere. We let the distractions of our life interfere. And while that sounds much nicer to understand, the honest thing is we are neglecting prayer by prioritizing the other thing. Look at the next verse. Here's Jesus' response. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. We talked about that. The flesh is weak. We are a fallen creation now, right? We get tired. We make mistakes. So we have to be intentional about making this prayer a priority. I already mentioned how Jesus did not get mad at him. He did not start beating on him or yelling at him. And then what? Pray. That's what he says. Pray. Why should they pray? Well, when I read that, I paused there and I tried to put different answers in to my blank. So why pray? Leave it open. First thing that comes to my mind, my Savior is in pain, is in sorrow. How many of you pray for your family, your friends? How can I pray for you? Hey, I've been having a real hard time lately. Can you just pray for my peace or my encouragement? And we do. And now here we are, Lord God Almighty, in the flesh, Jesus is in sorrow. First thing for me, Heavenly Father, I pray for Jesus. I pray for Jesus. I don't know what I can do. I know that you are far greater than I. The understanding is far above me. But I can say, be with Jesus. Another thing I had there. Why would Jesus tell them to pray? Well, we know when they came to arrest Jesus, there was a little incident with a sword and an ear getting cut off. Jesus knew this. So maybe he's saying, hey guys, I told you to watch and pray. Let's pray. Do this. Be ready so that you don't fall into the temptation of doing something like that. And through my study, some commentaries and theologians point out that Jesus, in telling them to pray so they don't fall in temptation, may have been referencing the denial, Peter's denial. Right? Because that occurs after Jesus is arrested. The guy who proclaims that he will never deny Jesus and he will be there through the whole time. And Jesus says, that's not true. And he warned them of that. He said, you're going to. You're going to do it. Now, Jesus looked me in the face and said, hey, you are going to fail three times before the rooster crows. I'm not going to sit back and go, oh man, okay, I'm going to fail. I'm going to say, Lord God, please help me. Help me not to fail. Help me to stand strong. Help me. I'm going to do that. And I think most of you would say the same thing. And I think that's a pretty safe assumption that if you're a disciple of Jesus in his inner circle and you've just been privy to that conversation, and now Jesus is saying pray, that that's something that should come up on your radar. So instead of beating them down and screaming at them, belittling them, he says, you couldn't even stay with me for 1 hour. Okay. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. He's even at that point in time trying to preserve his disciples, help them maintain their relationship with God. Here he is, all his pain, and he's looking out for them still. Right? That's like a pre-crucifixion moment when he's on that cross. Forgive them for they know not what they do. Even in his time of most pain and most sorrow, he's looking out for the people. He tells them to pray. So all those answers I gave you, and whatever answers you came up with on your own of why he was telling them to pray, come back to one thing. Prayer is a weapon in spiritual warfare. Whether we want to acknowledge it or not, we are all in a spiritual battle each and every single day. And prayer is a weapon. Not only is it a weapon on the offense, but it's a weapon as defense. It's a shield. Pray, why? So I don't fall in temptation. Prop up that shield, Lord God. Help me not to fall to these challenges. Right? Or if I've got a need, you pray for me. Now I wield my sword out. Lord God, I pray that you would come and help this person right now in their challenges that they are facing. That is calling into action our Lord God Almighty. One of my favorite examples, and I didn't do it in this because it'll take us much deeper, but how many of you watch war movies or been in the military when they had to call in air support or artillery? These guys are in the midst of a battle, and when it gets overwhelming and they're about to fall, they get on their radio and they say, I need air support now. They give the coordinates, and the show starts. Helicopters come in, jets come in, or missiles come flying in, and the enemy is defeated at the feet of those soldiers. That is what prayer can be and what prayer should be. When you pray, you are praying it into action. You're not saying silly little words that just sound good. You are calling on the power of God to interject into whatever situation it is you are praying for. Prayer is a weapon in spiritual warfare. Now, when we make prayer the priority, we get to remember all the things that prayer is, okay? All its abilities because it's of God. But only if you make it a priority. If it's just whatever, and you pray, oh, I'll pray for my hot dog, that's it. Or when I go to bed, pray that my dog Jake gets fed. We miss all those things. It becomes, I'm just doing something. I'm just doing something I told I'm supposed to do since I was little. But friends, I'm telling you, it's not too late. If that's what your prayer life is right now, One prayer will change that. Make the next prayer a prayer of action, a prayer of power, a prayer of comfort. Make it a priority. When we do that, it keeps hope in Christ right here. When we pray with the power of our Lord God, one cannot help but put their hope in Christ. It can't be done. When you are praying, expecting to see God's hand in action, you're not going to forget about prayer. You will find yourself becoming more intentional in all the ways you pray. For me, I was raised in a church. I've told many of you this. And in my teen years, I kind of wandered away. Wound up joining the Marine Corps, and I did that life. Right? I've told you all that I chose to be a good Marine instead of a Christian. And prayer became something we did when we had to. We pray for the meal, thank you for it. We pray to go to bed, don't let us die in our sleep. And I praise God that He revealed the reminder to me that it is so much more. And our church is a prayer church, I'm telling you right now. And if you're not part of that, be part of it. Every Tuesday we get together and we pray for our church and our church family. You are all invited. Be part of that action. If you look down next to you where your bulletins were or are, you'll see a card. I should have put it on the screen, but honestly, I forgot. So it looks like this. Okay, if you see one, you have it, kind of look at it. It's basically just a tracker. It's a goal tracker. If you're familiar with firearms or anything like that, it's like a log. It helps you learn what you're doing wrong, and helps you improve. Very simple. You've got a prayer focus. Let's make prayer intentional. Let's make it focused priority. Who am I going to make sure I pray for today? What am I going to make sure I pray for today? Write it down. How long do you want to pray for? Well, Lord God, how long do you pray? And what puts on your heart? Maybe it's only 10 minutes more a day. Maybe you have an hour set aside each day that you pray, and you're feeling led to add 10 minutes to it. Okay, awesome. Maybe you don't have an intentional time of prayer. Okay, let's add 10 minutes and make a 10-minute intentional prayer each day. And then the accountability. Did you reach your goal? Very simple. It's to help us keep it a priority. Maybe you set this next to your phone so you wake up in the morning and you look at it and go, okay, 10 minutes, I'm going to pray for this person and they're going to be my focus and I'm going to watch what God does in their life. There's going to be many of you who aren't going to use it at all. But I'm going to stand here and I'm going to say, please try. It doesn't matter if you pray 23 hours a day. You can be more intentional. You can add 10 minutes. Try it. Do it. Make it a priority for a week and watch what God does. We started with prayer because as we move forward throughout this month, there's going to be a couple other disciplines that'll be discussed to help us start our year in a more intentional, focused manner of glorifying God through our church, our community, this country, and all the world. But it starts with the basics. It starts with keeping our focus on Christ. It starts with our communication with the Lord. And this card will help you do that. When prayer is a priority, your hope will remain in Christ. Now, not only does prayer help the believer keep their hope in Christ, but that prayer also is what provides that initial hope in Christ for those who have not accepted Him yet as their Savior. Right? We often hear, repent of your sins, confess them, and ask Jesus to save your soul. That's a prayer. That is an incredibly powerful prayer. And that's where it starts. We pray out, Lord God, I'm a sinner in need of saving that only you can do. I'm sorry. I want to stop doing what I did, and I want to do what you want me to do. That is a prayer. That is a conversation you are having with God. During this next song, I'm going to be up here. I'm going to sit down. I'm not going to stand up here. I'm going to sit there, and I'm going to be praying for all of you. If you're feeling led now to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you want to pray with me, you want to talk to me, come up. If you'd rather wait till after service and you want to catch me and we'll talk, do that. If you want to sit right where you are right now and have that conversation with God, his ears still work. He will hear your prayers and answer. And maybe you've already accepted Jesus as your Savior, and you want to know about becoming a member of our church family to worship with us and be part of the inner workings of our church, be a member. You can find me after service. We can talk. Maybe you've accepted Christ and you're ready to be baptized. You haven't quite done it yet. You're nervous about it, whatever. You have questions. Again, I'll be more than happy to chat with you about that. Find me after service. We can sit there and we will lay out whatever you want to talk about. And we're also going to pray, because prayer is a priority. As we get ready to close the sermon part of the message, I'm going to pray. And I invite all of you right now to pray with me. And we're going to pray specifically for two things. We're going to pray that God uses this church to advance his kingdom. And we're going to pray for a healing touch in this nation. I'm going to ask you to pray for those two things. It'll be a short prayer, but I want us to do it together as we call down God's action. Let's pray. Lord God, you are powerful, and we thank you so much that you've given us an access to that power, Lord, through prayer, through the relationship with you. Lord, we pray right now as First Baptist Church, as the people who are here belonging to you, Lord, maybe visiting, we come together and we pray that your hand would bring us together as a united body of believers, that you would use us in glorifying you in this community. Make your will the focus, Lord, that you receive all glory. Help us to care for those who need caring and interject your love into the streets of Greencastle. And Lord, we come together and we pray now that your hand will be present on this nation, the United States, that we may be again what we once were, a United States. Lord, we need your hand present. I don't care what political party someone aligns with. I care who they serve, and that they allow you, Lord God, to guide them. Be present, Lord, and triumph over whatever divisions and pain and junk that's going on, Lord. You are bigger than it all. And we pray, Lord, and excitedly wait to see what you do. I thank you personally for each person in this service, whether they're here physically or at home in the stream, Lord. They are a blessing and part of this family. We thank you for them. We pray all of this together in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
God is greater than anything that's happened this week that you've seen on the news or that you've seen in Greencastle. Our God is greater. We're going to proclaim that right now before we leave our service this morning.
Our God is greater. There's nothing that trumps that. Our God is greater. Today we have our business meeting. That is open for members. So if you're a member, I encourage you to join. If you're visiting with us this morning, thank you. Thank you for worshiping together with us. We hope to see you again. You are formally invited back. Thank you. The benediction this morning comes from 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Let's pray. Lord God, we pray that right now that benediction will be on our lives, Lord. Help us to rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, because it's your will, Lord. I thank you for each person here in this service this morning. Be glorified through our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.